I know. You thought this was like a flashback or something,
right?
Like
what was happening?
60s
suddenly
at 6, 70s at 7?
Yeah, everything was different.
This is the Friday Matinee on your hometown station, AM 1220 KHTS. I'm George.
I am T, and we also have...
I'm Tori. What?
All of us together. What?
This is a dangerous thing.
It is a very dangerous thing, and we have a very brave guest with us today, and the reason we played Kodachrome is because once upon a time, boys and girls, when photographers used to take pictures, they used something called film.
Film.
And things have changed a little bit.
A series of chemicals and celluloid.
Yes, but things have changed a little bit, but the images, nonetheless, have become so incredibly important, but now it's a little bit different, and we have a guest with us today who's Mr. Camera.
And also kind of reflecting the changes in how news is reported and how people actually go out and work for the news industry now. It's a little bit changed in the last 20 or 30 years. He has a litany of experience in talking about different types of places and really super cool things. Let's welcome Mr. Tim Hart.
I kind of prefer Mr. Camera.
Mr. Camera.
Yeah, I'm gonna put that on my business
Camera.
Cards.
Mr.
I like
Camera.
That. So let's talk about this. I mean, we've known each other for a few years now, and you get up even earlier than I do most mornings.
Yeah, some mornings.
To go to work.
1 a.m. this morning.
Yeah. What?
That's a lot earlier.
And then you came to join us?
Yeah.
Wow, this is like serious that you're still vertical for starters.
I sneak naps in there.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I love
every
naps.
Stoplight.
So George does get up in the morning, and he's the talker. He delivers the news, you know, via the voice, which all of us do as Drive Time personality. You are out at 1 in the morning doing what are you doing? I mean, you don't have to tell me everything you're doing, but what are you doing?
Well, for example, today's client, they're on the air at 4:30 in the morning. Some of the local TV stations, they go on before that. They go on at 4.
Mm-hmm.
And whatever you need to put on the air just doesn't happen at 4 o'clock. You've got to be in there. Well, if you're using someone else's gear, like I was today, you have to go in and load up your car, camera and tripod and whatever else that you need for that day. It takes a while to drive to wherever you're going. Even at 1 o'clock in the morning, it's still an hour to get someplace. And then you got to set up everything. In the case of doing local television, you have to set up a live truck, a microwave truck, which involves, A, finding a place to park, putting a mast in the air, an antenna up 40 feet in the air, and sighting in that shot. Your transmitter has to align with a receiver on a mountaintop somewhere here in Southern California, and all that has to be done before that show goes on the air.
Now, as a photojournalist, you do the moving pictures too,
Yeah, this is television. Most of my work now is in television.
Yeah,
I kind of got into television on accident in college. I had always thought I would go to work for a newspaper or like Time magazine or something like that. And I was actually working part-time at a weekly paper in Bakersfield. And I got laid off. And the next day, I happened to be taking a radio production class in college. And the professor said, hey, the local NBC station needs people. They're hiring interns. And they're actually going to pay their interns.
Wait, what?
Yeah, exactly.
Don't tell ours.
Oh, boy. We're going to have to edit that out, sir. I'm sorry. We can't put that out there.
Let the back desk
They want to go to Bakersfield to do it. They might get paid. But, yeah, I was that afternoon, I was in the news director's office filling out an application and got a job as a production assistant. 2 months later, the assignment editor needed part-time photographers, and I had never done TV in my life, but I showed my portfolio of all my still work, and the guy said, well, you have an eye.
How old were you at this point?
20.
So you're just a baby who sees things in a way and captured it on film, and so at 20 years old, you actually had the portfolio to go in. I mean, that's the other part of doing a lot of this is preparation meets opportunity, and you had put in already some hours.
Preppatunity. Yes. Well, yeah. I actually took my preppatunity in high school. I sold my first picture when I was in high school. I was stringing for, like I said, that weekly paper in high school, and it was something that I wanted to do since I was just a little kid. I used to go to football games with my grandfather, and I saw this guy on the sideline taking pictures. Papa, what's that guy doing? So he works for the newspaper. He's taking pictures of the game. Next morning, we get the paper, and there's those pictures of the football game. And I'm thinking, that's his job? He gets paid to do that?
Oh, I love that.
That's now, you said stringing. What exactly for is, you know, those of us who don't know what you're
sorry,
talking about?
A stringer is a freelancer.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of even a level below. I don't say below, but it's a...
It's working its way up.
It's working
like
its
Peter
way
Parker,
up. Yeah.
Spider-Man. Let's throw a comic.
He was a stringer.
He was a stringer.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Now we have a reference point.
There you go.
Okay.
Peter Parker would be a stringer, yeah.
Wow.
But I want to talk about this because there's always been like freelance, but why isn't it that like if you're doing something for Channel 4 News, why aren't you an employee of Channel 4?
Oh, they have plenty of employees. They have plenty of staffers. They hire freelancers to fill in those gaps in the schedule that maybe they couldn't hire part-time for. And let's face it, it's budgetary too.
And everybody can't be everywhere at one time too.
That's exactly
right. If you want a campus or canvas an area, you've got to have those extra people.
Right.
And how long were you doing that? Because things have changed for you. We were talking about this before we went on air. How long were you doing that?
Well, I was a staff photographer at a couple of different TV stations until 1996. And then I got a job at CNN, was a staff photographer at CNN for 15 years. And then the last 5.5 years, I've been freelance.
And so now you're your own guy. You've got some gear. And how does that change? I mean, certainly, I guess the responsibility is that.
You know, the big difference is that before when I broke something, I could take it to engineering and they would give me something different and they would take care of the problem. When I break it, I got to pay for it.
Oh, the joy of ownership.
What are the pros though? There have to be pros that drove you to getting your own equipment and.
The pro is that when I go to work for somebody using their equipment, they're just paying me for my time. If I have my own equipment, they're paying me for my time and the rental of that equipment. And that rental of that equipment gets pretty expensive. And so I can work 2 days a week instead of working 5 days a week and make the same money.
There you go.
That's the business part of it.
Now, you do some fun stuff. You do the carpets.
Well, now, that's interesting that you would call it fun.
Well, I mean, I think it's fun. I think for us who get the information that you're out gathering, it's fun for us. Maybe not so fun for you. What is that like, going to something like the Oscars? Walk us through that kind of a day.
When you're doing a red carpet for the Oscars or the Emmys or any of those big events, they give you a space that's really not even wide enough to stand parallel or facing the red carpet for your shoulders, and then they ask you to squeeze as many as 5 people into that space. And it's...
That seems wrong.
It does seem wrong, but that's the way it is because there's so many more outlets now.
It sounded so glamorous before you told me what was happening. So now you have all these bodies crammed in so that you can watch people basically walk or trip on their gowns, hoping for that moment.
And
you know?
So that the reporter can ask, who are you wearing?
Who are you wearing? Do you get to talk to people when you do what you do?
I don't normally because I'm behind the camera. And as a photographer, I work best if people think that I'm furniture.
Okay. Because they forget you're there. You get the good shots.
Exactly. I want them to forget that I'm there. I want them to, if I leave and somebody says, I didn't even know you were there, that's how I know I've done my job right.
So you dress in all black, no bright pink or,
hopefully a lot of deodorant.
Yeah. Okay. So Emmy Sunday is always the hottest day of the year. You could make Emmy Sunday Christmas Day. It would still be a 95 degrees in Los Angeles and you're asked to wear.
It's like Mother Nature knows.
Yes. And you're asked to wear black petroleum-based rental suit on a red carpet in the sun on a 95-degree day. I did get away with shorts one day on the red carpet for the Emmys.
Wow.
What was the most memorable person on a red carpet anywhere? It doesn't have to be an award show, but it's just something that you shot that's the most memorable on a walkthrough.
I can't think of any of the...
Anyone trip?
You know,
anyone fall? Anyone...
We had 1 year at the Oscars where it rained, and that made things interesting. And
that was a couple of years ago.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. I was lucky enough to be... If you've ever seen the setup at the mm-hmm. Dolby Theater, everybody walks down Hollywood Boulevard and makes a right into the theater.
Right.
And there's a large walkway, and I got lucky enough to be there because I was doing stills that year. Because I do both still and video, and I was doing stills that year. So that was a nice place to be. It was my first time on a red carpet doing stills. It was a completely different atmosphere than doing video, because you're with a bunch of other photographers who are all yelling at their subjects. I don't yell at anybody. I don't want
people. And who's going to hear you anyway? What's the point?
Well, they're yelling because they want them to look.
Turn this way.
Out of focus shot.
Bring
that you
one of those. What are those things they use at a hockey game?
An air horn.
Oh, you'd be surprised what some of the photographers wear. There's one photographer in town who wears this gold wig.
Oh.
To get attention.
Let's get Tim a big feather, like a big peacock feather to
stick. I think kind of a big pimp
hat.
Except you
do that, and the shooters behind me would be throwing batteries at me.
Yeah, they'll be shooting you.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, have you ever done, I always think when I think photojournalists and doing certain things, Hollywood is great, but have you ever done doing news things, something where you thought, wow, this could be dangerous or this is probably not
where
I want
to be? Some stuff that I thought, wow, that was really stupid afterwards.
Yeah, that's the question I really meant to ask.
Yeah, a few times, more than once.
Are you at liberty to tell us?
Oh, sure. I was covering in Northern California, right at the California-Oregon border. The cops had found a large marijuana growing operation. And the only way to get there, to where this grove was to fly in by helicopter, except they couldn't land because it was on a slope. So they had to fly us in two at a time, hanging from the bottom of the helicopter. Helicopter would hover over our heads. We were wearing a harness around our waist. And we would clip into the harness as the helicopter was hovering overhead. And it'd take off, and it's about a 10-mile flight in.
And you're like hanging.
How fun is that?
Yeah.
You're hanging like a skeet shoot thing.
But not only that, taking stills as well. Was this a still?
Shooting or
no, I wasn't shooting that one.
You were just hanging on.
I had to hang on with one hand, the cable, with one hand, and then hold my arm out next to my side.
George, more Peter Parker than you thought.
Yeah, to keep from spinning around. If I had it held on with both hands, we would have gone spinning.
And at what point did you say that was stupid?
And I'm not doing this again.
The point that I said that this was stupid was when the helicopter pilot said, it was a pilot and a co-pilot, the pilot said, okay, if we have a mechanical problem and we start to go down, we cut the cable loose because it's better to lose two people instead of four.
Stop it.
Oh, just a little joke. Pilots play on their...
Just a cameraman. No big deal. Yeah. No big deal.
I had a partner on this shoot who refused to go on the helicopter ride, so he stayed behind and he shot me flying away. Oh. And on the way back, I had a small still camera and I couldn't take a selfie because it wasn't my arm. Was
and nobody knew that word yet.
Well, yeah. So I the only thing I could do is take pictures of my boots.
Wow. With the ground below. Yeah. Wow. Scary. Now, I hate when you're a doctor, I feel badly for people when they say, oh yes, I'm a doctor, and at the dinner table, all of a sudden, people are like, oh, can I tell you about this thing, this growth on my back? As a photographer, do you find that you're the go-to guy now? Because photography and imagery has become such a huge part of the zeitgeist. Everybody wants their Instagram, their Twitter, mm-hmm. and they want their image somewhere. Do people come to you and say, oh, here, hold, take this camera, take our picture? Do you find that's more, or have you always been that guy?
No, I've always been that guy anyways, and it doesn't bother me. In fact, I do a lot of mentoring for an organization called the National Press Photographers Association.
And what is that? Tell us about that.
National Press Photographers Association was formed in the 40s. Basically, it was formed, the idea behind it was to get cameras into courtrooms. They have a large legal component to the organization for First Amendment rights for photographers. It's also an educational organization. They do seminars for still photographers. They do what they call TV boot camp at University of Oklahoma every year to teach photographers how to be better photographers. And it's a great organization, help you find a job. They have a job bank, and like I said, they have a mentoring component too.
So you have a serious side besides the red carpet and the fun and the whatever. Did when you got into this business, did you think to yourself, this is the part I love, or do you kind of like the fluffy side too?
No, I don't really care for the fluffy side, to be honest with you. I'm a history geek, and I learned early on that doing what I do, I get to see that first draft of history. I get to write that first draft of history. I was on a campaign trip in 2008, and I called home to talk to my son, who at the time was 8 years old. And my son said, Dad, where are you today? And I told him where I was in Virginia. Who are you with? I said, I'm with Barack Obama. Do you know who that is? My son says, yeah, he's the senator from Illinois.
And wait, your 8-year old?
Yes.
Impressive. He knew.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's impressive.
At the time, he knew who all three of the candidates were, because we were still two, that was before Hillary dropped out. But he knew who all three of the candidates were. He knew what they did. He knew where they were, you know, the senator from New York or from Arizona, and he was following what I was doing, and he was learning these things. So that was where I really realized that, hey, not only am I writing that first draft of history, but I am covering the things. I'm writing the things that my son will learn about in school or my grandchildren will learn about in school down mm-hmm. the road.
That's nice.
Important stuff.
Important stuff.
And impressive, too, that an 8-year-old would know that.
Yeah, I was impressed.
Well, that's Dad's business, so the idea that you were sharing that with him, that was critically important.
Well, you talk about First Amendment rights for photographers, and I think that's a really important thing, and especially not only in the news, but you probably have run into times where people thought they could just take your camera away from you or not want you to be there.
Absolutely, and
no, you can't take someone's camera away, even if they're shooting somewhere that is trespassing. Call the police.
You can say a lot of things to me, but if you touch my camera, to me, that's an extension of me, and things get ugly fast.
And it's your business. I mean, if you were a delivery person or you were someone who used equipment for your line of business and someone came up, and that's your livelihood. That's your job.
Has anyone ever tried to do that? Ever reached out and touched, and what happened?
I either push back. I'm not a pushy kind of guy. I'm not a confrontational guy. But like I said, if you cross that line,
Krav Maga in your, your
that
line
camera
of,
is 26 pounds with a big battery on the back.
That's big enough.
Spin
that's
around
enough.
Really fast.
That's enough.
Yeah, at eye level, you're not going to be happy. But that's not something I want to do all the time.
Right?
It's
no, of course
I like
not.
To do. I try to avoid those confrontations because it gets in the way of my job. Like I said, I want to be furniture.
Yeah.
If I'm getting into a yelling match with someone, I'm obviously lost control of that situation, and I'm not able to do my job.
What's your take on the idea of, the amendment law, and that no one can take that, and you have the right to take the pictures? What's your take from behind the camera, since you do some of the fluffy, the people who are like, the paparazzi, those guys.
I think paparazzi, for the most part, do cross a line. When you start chasing after someone in a car and breaking traffic laws, that's crossing a line.
Whenever it becomes dangerous.
Yeah. I personally don't really care what celebrities are doing in their private time, so that's another reason why I don't care for what the paparazzi do. But at the same time, if it's something that's happening on public property, public space, and it's in full view of the public...
Your camera is just an extension of that.
What's the difference between a paparazzi's $6,000 Nikon and your iPhone?
Right.
True.
At that point, it's almost the same picture.
Right. Yeah.
But what we're talking about, when you get paparazzi, that they may be in a place they're allowed to be, but they've got that 300, 400, 500, 600 millimeter zoom lens, and they're trying to get into someone's backyard, or they've got the new law in California about the drones, especially
right.
hovering
and,
overhead.
And there is a legal standard as far as extraordinary measures to get that photo. If you're standing on someone, if you're standing on the sidewalk and you've got a zoom lens and you're shooting into someone's window, into someone's living room, that's different than shooting them on a sidewalk.
Exactly. Where is that?
Or even
where,
in front
exactly.
of their
house. Where is that line? Because what isn't that illegal to be shooting in my, someone in my house?
Yeah, it's
who's
not gonna public.
Who's going to sell those pictures?
Right.
There are plenty of people that will buy them, but there's the morality of who's selling it. Yeah.
And you hit a big point there. It's the morality. It's the ethics of those photos. And some people have more ethics than others.
And some just right here on Main Street.
And sometimes the decision comes down to a court case, unfortunately.
Yeah. Yeah. And there's a difference too in what you're doing in your house. If you've got the curtain closed, that's one thing, and you're trying to shoot a gap between the curtains from the sidewalk, that's clearly a problem.
Crossing the line.
But if you leave your curtains open and anybody can see it from the sidewalk, that's a different issue.
Yeah.
It could be argued, as they say.
Yes.
So now that you do this, you've moved forward. This has been a trend. This isn't something really new, but is it tougher for people to get into the industry now than it was? Because I know how old you are. We're talking about 30 years ago when you kind of got into this, and I know he doesn't look it. Boyish good looks. But is it tougher today than it was 30 years ago to get in the industry, you think?
I think it's tougher to make money at it than it used to be, because while there are more outlets. Those outlets are not pulling in the money that the outlets were when there were fewer outlets, if that makes any sense. So they're looking to get more for less money.
Exactly.
And, of course, you can do that. You can fill those gaps between the commercials, but where's the quality in what you're getting? You get what you pay for.
Exactly.
So that's one reason why the newscasts on your major networks, ABC, NBC, CBS, look different than what you see in the small market locals or on some of the smaller cable channels.
Hmm. Because or even
of
YouTube.
What they pay. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, see, that's another problem. Well, no, I shouldn't say problem, but a challenge. Your camera equipment that you do have, mm-hmm. I saw on your website, you were saying 4K, and I don't even know what that means. But is that like the best of the best now?
Yeah, well,
is that...
Everybody has a high-def TV now, right? Mm-hmm. Well, 4K is ultra-high definition. It's four times the picture resolution of...
So just clear, clear, clear picture.
Yeah.
And that's what everybody wants nowadays.
4K is what you watch when you're in a movie theater.
Oh. Really? Who wants to know where people aren't plucking? I don't understand why we need that kind of,
You're right, T. No, she's got a point.
Wow, I saw the zit on Channing Tatum's nose
but
there.
The great thing about 4K or even high-def is that... if the lighting is good and if the focus is right and you have enough, you have a shallow depth of field, which means an out of focus background, it looks 3D without having the 3D glasses.
Wow.
And that's what you get when you pay extra for a good photographer.
He knows the lingo.
Knows his lighting.
He totally knows the lingo.
So if you need to hire someone, we're telling you right now, Tim Hart, our guest here on the Friday Matinee, he's the guy you want shooting those pictures.
Right.
What is the website?
It is Hart Images Media Services. We don't spell it services. We spell SCVS because it's already a long name.
Gotcha.
HartImagesMediaServices.com.
And that's just for like media outlets. So this is something that you can show other media outlets what you've done, basically.
Yes, basically. Or I'm also looking to branch out and maybe do corporate video because there's good money to be made in that. And a lot of these corporate clients want that photojournalistic look.
Ooh. Oh, yeah. And something that makes them look fabulous, you know, that because everyone, that's important now. Images, everything. So they want you.
Right. Whether I'm working for a network or a local or a corporate client, it's still storytelling.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what it comes down to. And that's the difference between a photojournalist and a cameraman, is that I am out there telling stories, telling your story, telling whoever's in front of my lens. And every story has a beginning, a middle, and an end. And what a photojournalist does is illustrates those, that linear storytelling. When we're doing an interview, I just don't frame it up and let it go. I listen to what is being said during the interview. I listen to the questions. I listen to the answers. I have to get the shots that illustrate those answers, that show those answers.
Love that.
There is a difference between a finished news product, and now they're like tables on or channels on streaming, like Wall Street Journal, where they just show the raw footage.
And
sometimes
no storytelling,
it's totally out of context, and you're like, you don't really know what's going on. Right. So there is an art to it. Tim Hart. Hart Media Services. Sorry, Hart Media
Images.
Hart Media Images.
Hart
Images Media Services. Got it. We'll practice that later. Thanks so much. And of course, always good to see you, my friend.
Thank you, sir.
We will be back with more. This is the Friday Matinee on your hometown station, AM 1220 KHTS.